नमस्कार एंड वेलकम टू टुडेज एपिसोड ऑफ द जैमपॉट अड्डा। टुडे वी शैल डू सम सीरियस गपशप, समथिंग डिफरेंट फ्रॉम आवर यूजुअल एपिसोड्स। व्हाइल द वैक्सीन्स हैव ब्रॉट इन द मच नीडेड होप एंड ऑप्टिमिज्म, देयर आर मेनी क्वेरीज वी हैव इन माइंड एंड वी शैल एड्रेस सम ऑफ देम टुडे इन दिस एपिसोड विद थ्री सीनियर डॉक्टर्स। प्लीज वेलकम डॉक्टर सोमा दत्ता एमडी and Head of Pathology Department at Tata Motors Hospital, Jamshedpur. Dr. Deb Sanjay Nag, MD, Senior Consultant, Anesthesiology, Tata Main Hospital, Jamshedpur. And Dr. Rupam Gupta, MD and PhD, Medical Superintendent and Professor of Anatomy at CU Shah Medical College, Surendranagar, Gujarat. Well, he's a Jamshedpurian too, having grown up in the city. Thank you, doctors, for your time today. A pleasure and privilege to have you part of the Adda. And please accept our heartfelt gratitude for being the superheroes on the front line and fighting selflessly against the pandemic. Thank you so much, because it's people like you who've made our lives easy in the last 1 year of the battle that the whole humanity race has been facing with. Before we deep dive into the questions on vaccination, and you know, we've been getting a lot of queries, we would want to know a little bit about how you manage the COVID times. You know, it's a never-ending, never-before situation, something our generation has never encountered, and we label it as a new normal. So, Dr. Soma, why don't we start with you at Telco Tata Motors Hospital? How did you manage that?
Thank you, Sukanya, and thank you, Jampot Adda, for inviting me here. Of course, the year 2020, it posed an unprecedented challenge for healthcare professionals all over the world. And the proportion of the pandemic and the speed with which it arrived, it was not anticipated by most of us. I remember it was somewhere early 2020 when we were still, you know, seeing those videos which were circulating on the social media regarding what was happening in China and even in Italy. Little did it strike us that it will hit us so hard and so soon. The preparations in our hospital began somewhere, say, early March, just after Holi. We began our several series of meetings. And also at that point of time, the information was very little regarding the disease, regarding the virus. Even we doctors, we did not have much information as to how the disease was spreading, what were the diagnostic modalities, what modes of treatment was, you know, had effective impact on it. There were several webinars, and we were also gradually learning on the way. Another problem which we faced was regarding the procurement of PPEs. If you remember, during the lockdown period, in the initial stages, there was a huge shortage of PPEs. So then again, we had to resort to, you know, indigenous, like, you know, there were we roped in the local agents who helped us out with indigenous formats of PPEs. Then there was again the training of our staff. They needed to be trained on how to don and doff. Various kinds of new protocols had to be devised. Especially everything had to be reworked, you know, right from how the patient will enter into the hospital, process flow after that. Various wards were demarcated, you know, into the red zones, green zones. So every little detail had to be reworked. There were several rounds of meetings. And it was, of course, totally new to all of us. A lot of medicines had to be procured, ventilators. And of course, I must, we are very thankful in Jamshedpur for the Tata management. They have contributed immensely, both our Tata Main Hospital as well as the Tata Motors Hospital have played a significant role, and they have immensely aided the government in tackling the pandemic in Jamshedpur, right from setting up quarantine centers, isolation facilities, COVID care facilities. The Tatas have provided free COVID treatment to maybe hundreds and thousands of patients. So yes, the contribution made by the Tatas were immense. So there were a lot of things which was going simultaneously, and it was a huge learning experience for all of us.
Right. So Dr. Deb Sanjay, from your end, from the TISCO side, the Tata Main Hospital, what was the situation and how did you and your colleagues manage that?
See, Dr. Soma had touched it very well. The Tata group had actually the support to the citizenry of Jamshedpur was phenomenal from the Tata group. So the first COVID response from the organization, Tata Main Hospital, came out on the 3rd of March. We remember it fondly because it's the Founders Day. So just after the Founders Day, the first guidelines for how we face this pandemic started, and then our preparation started. Luckily, what happened as the pandemic panned out over the country, what happened, we got our first COVID. Till now, we have treated over 4,000 cases of COVID in the hospital. And possibly this is one of the biggest private sector COVID hospitals in the country today, and catering to more than 4,000 people, patients being treated with the best of treatment, the best of drugs, the best of critical care facilities, the best of medicines, the best of diagnostics. I think that's a phenomenal support that Tata Group has provided to the community in and around Jamshedpur. And not only we are aware of, not only in the Jamshedpur, every area where Tata Group has a footprint and at other locations also, the support has been phenomenal. And obviously the start was difficult because as we are all aware, it was during the period of lockdown. So it was a resource constrained environment. The supply chain was constrained. Getting equipment, getting drugs was a challenge because globally there was a shortage of all critical care equipments. So shipping them from various locations and getting the drugs for our patients, that was a huge challenge. But luckily, thanks to the Tata Group, we had all the support and we were able to manage it and contain the pandemic. And obviously, it was till now, we have been able to restrict. The number of patients have come down significantly. We still dread the day when we had more than 1,000 beds managed over the city. And it was not only the positive patients who were in the hospital, we were managing quarantine centers. We are managing isolation centers for people who were positive but asymptomatic. And it is not only the patients, the entire people who were caring for those patients, keeping them in isolation, managing their travel, their stay, their food, the resources. So everybody, not only the doctors and the healthcare workers, everybody working with the organization actually came forward. We all thought before the COVID pandemic came that we were very busy. But actually the COVID pandemic taught us that work actually, what actually busy means. So that was a huge learning for all of us. And obviously things have changed forever. The learnings we had over the last 1 year now, it started in March. The world has been facing it since beginning of January, China possibly in December. But the learnings will be there for with us for a lifetime.
Very true. Dr. Rupam, you are in Gujarat where the numbers were possibly far higher than, you know, from the two hospitals that we have the doctors from. So what has been your learnings, your challenges for you and your colleagues?
Sukanya, actually, you see, I handle a teaching hospital. So of course, I would just ditto what Dr. Soma and Dr. Nag has told. Apart from that, the major learning for me was, you know, that I also would like to highlight the angle of the patients. Because normally in a hospital, you know, the patients, relatives, the attendants, they freely are allowed during visiting hours or otherwise also to meet patients. We can interact with them more and more, you know. Now, along with what Dr. Nag and Dr. Soma has told, now, there was another angle of the patient's relative side. You know, there was, I could understand, I am sure Dr. Nag will also agree with me, that there was also a situation where somebody in your family is sick and you're not able to take care of that person. Okay. So we used to be also faced with that challenge. We used to organize, you know, video calling sessions for, because I have a public hospital over here. So we used to arrange for those kind of interactions between relatives, you know, that guilt conscious used to come to their, you know, children and all. And of course it was banned that you can't enter, you know, those areas except for the PPs and all those things. So that was another challenge which I did feel. In Gujarat, there was a lot of, you know, bureaucracy which was involved. So it was not that comfort zone which Tata's provide over there. So we had to fight with that also. It is quite difficult, you know, to sometimes get your message across to, you know, hardcore administrators. They are in their own, you know, targets and their own, you know, setups. So you may not find your administrators on the same page. So of course, the Disaster Act was, you know, put on the whole of India. So many times I found myself, you know, battling very strange kinds of, you know, situations also. The government did come out to support us, but again, being a private hospital, we did face those constraints about PPEs acquiring, medicines acquiring, and many things like that. But the patient angle was something new to me, you know, that I had never faced with any other kind of a disease of, you know, of course, it was a pandemic of this nature, which God forbid any time comes again. That was my interesting take, you know.
So, yes. So, you know, the word superheroes is therefore, I would say, an understatement for all of you in the medical fraternity today, how you've been battling with your, you know, within your constraints, new learnings, because you've never, you know, faced this before. So, you know, it's starting everything from a clean slate. You're working on new guidelines, new policies, new methods of treatment, possibly. But I guess with the vaccine now, you know, there is some hope, some optimism amongst the general public that chalo, COVID se chutkara milega. But is that so? Let's come to the questions. Dr. Rupam, we start with you. Is the vaccine safe? Does the vaccine guarantee immunity against all the variants of COVID?
Sukanya, actually, you know, when you say, is the vaccine safe? You know, it's a, for us in the medical fraternity, this safe word is a very relative word, you know, because you see the body ourselves, we are dealing with a very complex system. So what definition of safe or safety do you say that itself is a very, you know, abstract thing, because it's not only your body, so many systems working, plus also your environment, and given this kind of a pandemic situation. So what is safe is a very relative thing. But as far as the message regarding this vaccine is concerned, of course, it's very, very safe, you know, because all the regulatory authorities in India have given the clearance. And believe me, whatever we say, they do take care. Imagine what was at stake if the government would have launched a half-cooked vaccine, as was so many times reported in the media. Imagine the government would have fallen, you know. So I'm sure that the DCGI, you know, the other regulatory bodies, they did a wonderful job. It is very difficult to make the general public aware regarding these, you know, different clinical trials, you know, phase one, phase two, phase three, and things like that. So it was a very, you know, favorite debate for most of the TV channels, which fueled so much of, you know, this misconceptions. But one thing is there, believe me, this vaccine is safe. In my district, I was the first one, in fact, to get vaccinated myself. Of course, there are some, you know, issues related with every vaccine, the AFIs we call them. But that is another role, both Covaxin and Covishield. Both the methodology, the platform on which they work, they are quite safe. Regarding the, you know, variants, because see, variants come due to mutations, and mutations is a very, very random thing. Like mostly it is the spike proteins which, you know, our immune system recognizes. Now, if there is some mutation which plays around with those spike proteins, then of course the efficacy of this vaccine will not be that much as we expect. Or it may not be also. But again, a mutation affecting those, you know, characteristics of the virus is a very random thing, you know. So what I feel, given the choices right now, given the regulatory bodies' decisions right now, it is very, very safe. Plus, see, 16th of Jan, this vaccine was launched all over India. And lakhs and lakhs, I can't quote the exact number, have been vaccinated. You know, there was no acute, you know, anaphylactic shock or something like that, which I came across, even in the media. So it is not that the vaccine is not safe. And I would certainly say that let us trust the, you know, regulatory bodies, and let us trust our scientists, and we should all go for this vaccine. That is my take.
Right. So Dr. Soma, do we have a choice for the vaccine? So two are already out, and we hear from the news reports that the third one could be out in the month of June. So as general public, can we say, no, we want this, no, we don't want that? So do we have the choice?
Yeah, as Dr. Rupam has said, presently there are two vaccines which are available. That is the Covishield, which was developed by Oxford and AstraZeneca, and is being manufactured by the Serum Institute of India. And the Covaxin, which has been indigenously developed, it is an inactivated vaccine developed by Bharat Biotech, which is based out of Hyderabad. So the vaccination program is being run by the government, and in the first phase, it has rolled out the vaccine to all the healthcare providers. And eventually in the next phase, they will be covering the other essential workers and the citizens who are more than 50 years of age, or those the citizens with comorbidities. So at this point of time, presently, this is a government-run program. The vaccine is not available in the open market, and we do not have a choice as to which one, you know, whether it is Covishield or Covaxin. But once this is done, I feel the government may get into a partnership with either the private organizations or the corporates, you know, to roll out the vaccine in a much speedier manner and to have a broader coverage. And as you rightly said, we will most probably have more vaccine candidates in the future, and it will be available in the open market. So maybe at that point of time, we may have a choice of vaccine when it is available in the open market. But as of now, it is not available.
Right. So Dr. Deep Sanjay, you know, everyone's worried about side effects. Everyone's talking about, you know, what will happen if I get a fever after the vaccine, or a you know, kind of a body ache. So, you know, what are the typical side effects that one can or one should keep a lookout for, and what should be reported in case it's not within the list of side effects?
See, most of the vaccinations, especially the injectable ones, the commonest one, obviously will have some amount of pain at the site of injection. That follows any injection. So that is the commonest one, and associated with that, possibly for a day or two, there will be some pain at that site. We have seen this most commonly, adults have the hepatitis vaccine. So it's very similar to that. Similarly, most of us will be having some amount of myalgia, some amount of, and again, a very small percentage will have a mild fever, some may have a headache and things like that. It's actually, the side effects are bare minimum. Very few people are having them. The maximum, most common, as I said, with any injection, it is a pain at the site of the injection. Apart from that, milder things like a small headache or a giddiness, nausea, some amount, somebody may have some mild vomiting symptoms. These are the common ones which we have. Common ones, as I say, it is again a very small percentage. So common side effects, I'd call. Very few people would actually have the side effects. The rarer ones are like an anaphylaxis or a severe allergic reaction. That is common to anybody who gets a vaccine. The other vaccines which we commonly have, like the ones we have for our kids. So the incidence of anaphylaxis with the vaccine, the COVID vaccine, the incidence is very similar to the other vaccines which we have. So there is no difference. The incidence is 1 in 2 million. So we can rest assured. It gives us the safety. It gives us the confidence that we will be safe after we complete the dosing.
Dr. Rupam, we've been hearing a lot about herd immunity. You know, the WHO brings out reports, and especially in such cases of pandemics. So when do you think realistically Indians will come to that stage of herd immunity, or have they already reached the stage? Or what percentage of population needs to get vaccinated to develop the herd immunity?
Okay, see, Sukanya, this word as herd immunity, you know, the basics are that there is an agent, you know, it is the, let's, for in this case, it is the coronavirus, that is the agent. Then we have the host, we are the hosts, the human beings, okay, especially our respiratory system and all, this is the host. And then we have got the environment. So this forms a triad, you know, if I remember my community bets it right. So actually the main goal of herd immunity is to break this triad, okay. Like suppose if at all, like you must be hearing about the UK variant and, you know, the South African variant and all these new mutations. So the fear right now is ki if some, you know, some guy having this infection comes down to our country right now, then what happens? So in that case, if everybody around is vaccinated, okay, and they have a certain amount of immunity, a resistance against this coronavirus, then even if we have an agent coming into such a society, it does not get a host. Therefore, you break the barrier over there. Okay. And so that is the whole idea about herd immunity. Now, the calculation part, the statistical part about herd immunity, what percentage? This 60%, what we commonly hear, this was, you know, this is a calculation for, let's say, for polio, for poliomyelitis. Okay. So it was calculated that, you know, herd immunity of 60% will prevent poliomyelitis in general population, and therefore we can proudly say that we have eradicated polio and things like that. But this time will tell. Right now it is too early to come to these calculations, okay? But it does not depend only on the vaccination, okay? It depends on the virulence also. It depends on the nature of the microorganism also. It depends also on our, you know, appropriate behaviors also. There are so many factors. So there are many scientists who are pitting this high up to 80-90% also. Itna hoga, then only we can, you know. But interestingly, you know, in this phase of coronavirus, I also realized a strange, you know, demographic patterns. Most of the rural masses, somehow I felt that the disease did not penetrate, thankfully so, in these rural masses. Whereas they were not following all the norms also, but I was surprised why. So there may be so many innate factors in us. Maybe that old, you know, feeling of how our kids or the in the rural areas, the kids are allowed to play in the dust and all that kind of thing. And therefore their innate immunity is more better than the urban areas. So there have been other factors also. It's difficult to say what percentage about the herd immunity, but yes, it is important that as much as possible, everybody should take the vaccine, at least in these micro environments. So kya hoga ki even if the you know, if there is a infiltration, it will be a local one and the administration will be able to contain it in a better way. So that's about herd immunity, Sukanya.
Right. Dr. Deb Sanjay, now coming to the number of doses that one is expected to take. So how many doses would be taken and at what intervals? And you know, can a person get affected with COVID even between the scheduled doses? Is that possible? And what happens if the second dose is missed? That's a very common query that's coming.
Yeah, so the dosing is you take the first dose and the second dose is scheduled after 28 days. Now what happens is what current research has shown that after 14 days after the first dose, you may get the infection because ultimately the 70% immunity which the vaccine is claiming to provide, that will happen only after 14 days of the second dose. But during the interim period, after you have taken the first dose, after 14 days, even if you get the infection will not be as severe as you would have had it without the vaccine. So there is some good news even with the first dose of the vaccine. And second part, obviously, if you miss the second, you shouldn't miss actually. But even if you miss it, the current guideline says that you can take it within the next 2 to 3 months. But ideally, obviously, the government guideline says that the next dose is to be taken after 28 days. The immunity comes after 14 days of the second dose.
Right. That's good news. Even as you said, after the first dose, also, it's not that severe if in case somebody does contact this particular infection. Dr. Soma, you're from the pathology department. So, you know, if a person has recovered from COVID, is it essential for him or her to get inoculated? You know, can a person presently having COVID be vaccinated as well? So two scenarios.
See, once a person recovers from COVID infection, he develops some protective antibodies in his blood. Now, how long these antibodies, can last anywhere between a few weeks to even a few months. The exact duration, how long they last in the blood is not yet known. Also, what we do not know is the level of antibodies at which it will confer protection against further reinfections. So it is definitely advised for people who have already recovered from COVID infections in the past, they are advised to take the vaccines because it will further boost their immunity and it will prevent future reinfections from occurring. Because we already have documented cases of reinfection. Several cases have been reported. One thing we have to keep in mind is if people have taken you know, monoclonal antibodies or convalescent plasma therapy during their course of treatment, then the vaccination should be deferred by a period of at least 3 months. Otherwise, any person who has recovered from COVID infection should definitely be taking the vaccine. Coming to the second part of the question, I think what you wanted to know is if a person is suffering from an active infection in the prison. See, it's not only about an active COVID infection. Even if a person is suffering from any active acute infection or any febrile illness, he is advised not to, it is recommended that he doesn't take the infection because, he doesn't take the vaccine because when you are suffering from any active infection, your immunity is low. So the vaccine will not elicit an adequate immune response. So it is recommended that the person recovers from the active infection and then he can go ahead with his vaccination.
Right, right. So we're almost at the end of the discussion and very few questions left. So Dr. Rupam, now with everyone, majority of the population, you know, having lifestyle diseases, do you think this vaccine is going to interfere with the medicines that people normally are used to for a blood pressure or a diabetes? Is there any kind of interference with that kind of a medication?
Sukanya, no. In fact, the vaccine manufacturers have clearly mentioned that there is no interference, except that if you're taking some blood thinners, you know, anticoagulants and all, in that case, it is not contraindicated. That is not that you should not get vaccinated, but when you're getting vaccinated, the environment should be such that backup facilities are available because there might be bleeding disorders or something like that during that episode. Another take on it is that if you are taking, you know, other drugs, antihypertensives, antithyroid, whatever, that means you belong to the comorbid category. Okay. You are more prone to getting a corona infection, a COVID infection, and that infection might, be more severe in you if you have got comorbidities. Therefore, it is in fact more important that people who are on chronic medications, whether it's antihypertensives, antidiabetics, and all, they should come forward and take this drug more and more. And get vaccinated completely. That is more important for them, in fact. So there is no, you know, interaction or anything like that per se.
That's good news, I guess, for a lot of people. Dr. Deb Sanjay, coming to health passes and immunity passports, you know, the world's talking about this kind of proofs, documentation that one has been vaccinated, one is fine, especially with respect to, you know, moving international borders, etc. So will there be some kind of a document or a health card or a proof indicating that a person has taken vaccine? How would people say, you know, yes, I've been vaccinated?
This vaccine, we actually know vaccine will give you 100% immunity. So this vaccination working as an immunity passport, that is a long way away. But there are some sporting events and specific functions which will need a vaccination certification, like the Olympics. We are hearing that they are trying that most of the people who are coming to the Olympics, most of the players, they are vaccinated. Similarly, say for we have some ICC tournaments or any of the tournaments, what we are cricketing events. So these are areas they are looking out that all the people who are playing, they are vaccinated. But it is a long way away that everybody who wants to travel has to carry a vaccination passport because vaccinating the entire global community, it's a long way away. And as Dr. Soma was saying earlier, we still don't know whether the antibodies we develop after we have an infection, how long it stays in our body, because TMH has done a research study on this and we see a significant percentage of the people are actually losing these protective IgG antibodies over a period of 1 to 3 months. So this has been published from TMH very recently and now is a part of the WHO global literature on COVID. So we are seeing this phenomenon, but what happens is the IgG antibodies are not the only antibodies which gives you immunity. What happens is there are some memory cells also which provides us immunity. So even if the IgG protective antibody goes, possibly these memory cells actually, they provide the infection, and whenever we are faced with the COVID virus, these memory cells get stimulated and start producing the antibodies once again. So the current understanding of how the protective mechanism for these vaccine and as well as protection against the virus works, it is in the phase of evolution. We are learning every day. And just for example, we don't know how long the vaccine is valid, whether it is 6 months or 1 year protection or longer. So most of the manufacturers, they haven't told us as yet what is the duration of immunity it will provide. So because we have actually fast-paced the development of the vaccine. These are answers we are looking for. And with time, possibly, we will have these answers.
Right. Dr. Soma, do you think that in the future, you know, this the COVID vaccination will start featuring in the immunization cards of babies, kids, like we normally have the rest of the list? At some stage, you know, will the world move towards that kind of a thing?
Right now, it's not recommended for people below the age of 18 years. So further studies will have to be conducted regarding the safety and efficacy of the vaccines in this in the pediatric population before any such recommendations are made. The efficacy trials are going on regarding its use in various age groups, especially in the pediatric population as well as in the elderly age group. So the vaccine is presently not recommended for children as well as for pregnant mothers and lactating women. Now whether or not it will be included in the universal immunization schedule, it remains a subject for further studies, because that will depend upon the result and the outcome of, you know, large scale studies which will be conducted in various centers worldwide. And also, as Dr. Sanjay Deep has pointed out, we do not exactly know how long the immunity is going to last. Although the vaccine provides, you know, both humoral, that is a B cell, as well as it elicits the T cell response. We also know, because Corona is an RNA virus, so it is much more prone to mutations. So right now there are a lot of knowledge gap which exists. So we do not know whether the vaccines are going to be effective against the new mutant strains or the other strains which may emerge in the future. So it is, I think, too premature to speculate whether it can be included in the, you know, the vaccine, the immunization schedules as we have. Of course, a lot has happened, but a lot is still happening in this field. And we have to, you know, further consider the, you know, the efficacy studies as and when they come out. So, yeah, as of now, it is not recommended for children. So,
right,
we have to wait for the further studies.
Right. Coming back to the last part, what is the advice for the general public? I mean, will it be a mask on, mask out, sanitization? Yes, no sanitization, you know, that kind of a life. What is your advice as doctors? Dr. Rupam, we start with you.
Okay. You see, Sukanya, this was, of course, an unprecedented times we have been through. What is my advice is that, number one, you see, Corona is not over as yet. It's a global village now. Unless, again, it's wiped out from the face of the earth, as we say, you cannot, you know, relax. It'll just take a few, you know, people coming from abroad, and the whole thing happening once again, which I really fret, and hopefully it doesn't happen. But still, we have to see it in this way. Initial days, I did see a sort of a denial phase in many of, you know, us, where this is happening in Wuhan, this is happening in China, it's happening in UK, but it will not happen to us. That's a very, you know, a positive denial mode we had gone into. So this window period that we have right now, thankfully, the you know, cases have decreased. This is the perfect time where we all should get vaccinated. There is a lot of, you know, misinformation, mistrust, and things like that. But we all, as a, you know, whole, as Indians, we should not get into this, because you see, once you do get COVID positive, then you don't ever question why are you being given remdesivir. I remember asking one of my, you know, doctor colleagues, because as I think both my medical fraternity will agree with me, it is we doctors who are also very much in two minds, whether to take it or not, you know, the vaccine and all. But I also question my own doctors, do you remember the pharmacodynamics of remdesivir that you're so freely prescribing? So there was a story of HCQ, there was a story of chloroquine and, you know, what not, whether it works, whether it doesn't work. But important thing is that you have to trust. You have to trust our regulatory bodies. You have to trust the strategies of the government. They are thinking on a very larger scale. They are at such height where they can see much beyond our vision at, you know, we are minuscules in front of them. Second most important thing is don't take COVID disease lightly. Prevention is still a best cure. Many of my, you know, junior colleagues, especially the residents, एक बार हो जाने दो, देन वी विल गेट यू नो इम्यून फॉर एवर एंड ऑल. डोंट टेक दिस चांस. इट इज नॉट सो इजी. वी डोंट नो दिस इनविजिबल एनिमी एट ऑल. सो इट इज बेटर टू प्ले सेफ. See, it causes fibrosis. Fibrosis is known by its effect. How long it is? It's also an RNA virus. What kind of games it will play? I remember the, you know, I think Dr. Soma will agree with me. You see the example of chickenpox and herpes zoster. This chickenpox, which we get at kids, you know, and we just play around. Ki chalo ho gaya, nothing big about it. A few pimples here and there. But when your immunity gets down in the adult age, and then when those dormant virus, when they start coming back again, it is that same infection which gets re-enlightened in the later phase. So there are so many, you know, virus as a whole is a very, very strange thing. So let us not take corona lightly. Of course, corona is here to stay. As most people predict, it will become a common cold and stay with us forever. We just hope that this is the best sequel to the whole, you know, episode. But don't take, you know, please do take it seriously, the advice of masking up, the advice of maintaining social distance, if not social distance, at least physical distance, because many of my colleagues pointed out ki social distance nahi bolna chahiye. It is a bad term for, you know, it should be physical distance. And second, and but not at all, there are so many lessons to learn. Of course, this digital media, I was very much averse to, you know, talking on Zoom and all these things where it was available. Abhi koi chara nahi hai, therefore I have become, you know, good at it. So there were so many good lessons also to take from this COVID, and we realized our family lives and so many good things. So I think there are positives, there are negatives. Learn to live with corona, learn to befriend corona. And I think vaccination is one way forward. We are in that window period. We better make the best of it. We better, you know, shield ourselves. And that is why I always say COVID shield is to shield yourselves. And especially the corona warriors, we who are in the forefronts, we better remain, you know, in that shielded form so that we can serve the society better. That's my take on it.
Dr. Soma, from your end, any further additions to what Dr. Rupam said?
Yes, I definitely echo Rupam's thoughts. See, we have to realize two things, that there should be no room for complacency, because the pandemic is far from over, especially now that we are in a stage where the cases are, you know, rapidly declining. So, because we have seen the emergence of new mutant strains in other countries, which have led to a second peak. And we should capitalize on the advantageous position that we as a country now are in with this early vaccine rollout and the tremendous manufacturing capability that we have for, you know, mass scale production of vaccines. So, yes, we should certainly have, you know, go aggressive with our vaccines and try for a very broad coverage and as speedily as possible, because, you know, that will help us, you know, capitalize our gains and it will consolidate our gains. What we have to essentially remember is, you know, what are the potential endpoints for the vaccine? See, one is the, you know, the primary reason that the vaccines are there is to reduce the disease burden in the community. It reduces the mortality and the morbidity due to the disease. Now, whether we are not sure whether the vaccine is going to prevent infection, whether it is going to reduce the risk of disease transmission. And that is why there is a need to continue with physical distancing, wearing masks in public places, hand hygiene. So that coupled along with, you know, aggressive vaccination drive, this will really help our nation. And I also feel, you know, we might have a lot of, you know, exciting new developments regarding vaccines in the near future. We may come across some single dose vaccines or vaccines which come out as nasal spray, or maybe even the multivalent vaccines, you know, which are which will be effective against multiple strains of coronaviruses. So definitely a lot of new developments are awaiting us. So we should be prepared for, you know, a lot of changes in the vaccine landscape, and we should embrace these changes as quickly as possible. And I'll definitely say that we have a long way to go, but we have come a long way. And we should appreciate our scientific community for, you know, what they have achieved in such a short span. And yes, so right now vaccines along with this preventive measures is the best bet that we have.
Right. Dr. Deb Sanjay, from your end, before we conclude, your thoughts, your advice to the people.
I'd like to end on a positive note. Advancement of healthcare facilities available in the country and globally, I think we'll see an end to this pandemic even sooner. But the vaccination is the way forward. By vaccinating, we'll actually acquire what we call the herd immunity. Nobody knows the details of how, what percentage and how many people need to be vaccinated, how many doses. So that we will keep learning as we evolve. But till all of us have closed this pandemic, the masking, the distancing and hand hygiene and those things we have to continue. There is no room for complacency, but the vaccine is there. I'd request everybody to come forward, and whenever their turn comes, please come forward and take it. It is safe as any of the pediatric vaccines you have taken in your childhood.
Okay, that was great. So thank you so much, doctors. And I'm sure our viewers have benefited, and let's hope we get back to normalcy sooner than expected. And I'm sure if there are any questions from our viewers, you will address them through the chat box when the episode is telecast. So thank you once again, and best wishes to all of you. With that, we come to an end of another episode. We shall see you very soon. Till then, stay safe and goodbye.